Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to read just a few sentences here and lead to a quick question. Thank you guys for your careers and your help. This is very helpful today. I'm encouraged because so far this committee has really addressed this issue in a nonpartisan, I'm not even going to use bipartisan, it's a nonpartisan issue. This is the security of our country, and indeed, I think the security of the world. But this is from the JCPOA. This historic JCPOA will ensure that Iran's nuclear program will be exclusively peaceful. Iran reaffirms that under no circumstances will Iran ever seek, develop, or acquire any nuclear weapons. This JCPOA will allow Iran to move forward with an exclusively peaceful indigenous nuclear program in line with scientific and economic consideration. I just have one question, the whole process. We started in the beginning and allowed them to have enrichment in the very beginning. There are 18 countries, and we talked about this yesterday, there are 18 countries out of 180-plus countries in non-proliferation treaty. There are 32 countries that have enrichment, or I'm sorry, that have peaceful nuclear programs. There are only 18 that have civil programs but can enrich, 18. So there are only about 14 countries that have the combination. Only 9 countries have the bomb. 5 countries have civil programs but are not allowed or that can enrich, countries like Germany and Japan. So my question is, if you look at this thing historically, we did a similar deal with North Korea, and it didn't work out so well. I think we might have been naive in looking at it in historical terms. The problem with this deal that I can see so far, and I'm still trying to look at it in a measured way, truthfully, is that this deal, in my mind, does not preclude Iran from becoming a nuclear weapon state, even though we just saw the intent of the agreement was to do that. I think, Mr. Nephew, even this morning, you said over time we talked about the sunsets and so forth. This deal, over some period of time, certainly gives them an opportunity to have a nuclear weapon. So when I look at this thing, it comes down, do we have a false choice, accept this deal or war? And I don't accept that. And my question this morning leads to that. But initially, when we did this enrichment and allowed them to go that way, it in my mind, violates the very issue that we have here, a peaceful indigenous nuclear program does not require enrichment. And although we've now taken that up as a presumption, and I challenge that, but that's historical, it's given. In this agreement, they are allowed to enrich. So I have a question. So if we have to go it alone, let's just say, I'm trying to understand, is there an alternative to the position we're in right now? And I'd like both of you to address, in my opinion, I'm a business guy. I'm an outsider of this process. You don't sanction countries, you sanction companies. And so when you look at the financial industry and their energy industry, and you sanction from our $18 trillion economy, and you start sanctioning businesses, you can have a lot of teeth. We don't need any other sanctions, in my opinion, to really have a dramatic impact on this regime. And we know from the past history, recent history, just in the last 5 years, under this administration, when they doubled down on those sanctions, it brought them to the table. In my opinion, we gave in too early. My question to both of you this morning, do we have an alternative that we haven't talked about in detail, and that's another alternative to war or this deal as it is? Mr. Nephew?
Senator, I think it's a very important question, and I don't know that you're like my answer. My view is that...
Why would you say that?
Well, I think at the end of the day, while it's certainly true that it would be our preference that Iran not have an enrichment program, there is nothing in the Non-Proliferation Treaty that goes back to the late 60s that precludes countries from having one. The way in which we were able to mount all this pressure and all these sanctions on Iran is because, as Senator Menendez was describing, they engaged in years of cheating on that program.
But right? I'm sorry to interrupt, but they went back and said, look, we need to have enrichment because we can't secure a consistent flow of material. And yet 18 countries do that. So I push back a little bit on the presupposition.
Well, but sir, those 18 countries were not subjected to the kinds of pressure and sanctions campaign and
they
tactics.
They weren't violators of NPT laws like this regime has been either.
That's correct. And that's why I would never apologize for what we have done. But the practical reality is that Iran in 2015 faces a history in which we attempted to strangle the nuclear program in the cradle as often as we possibly could, including throughout the 1990s. And even going back beyond that. From the Iranian perspective, they could not sign on to a deal that didn't enshrine their ability to have an indigenous nuclear energy program, including enrichment. And while that certainly would not have been my preference going into this conversation, I started my jobs as the guy going after Iranian enrichment efforts, the practical reality is we faced a country that was not relinquishing this this right and this capability.
We're going to run out of time. I want to address the idea of is there an alternative to what we're doing now? In other words, we've got to consider that. If we don't agree with this deal, do we have an alternative?
Sir, my view is that if we don't agree to this deal, the Iranians are going to start installing more centrifuges, and if we get back to the table, we're going to be dealing with 30,000 centrifuges and a completed reactor.
Specifically, though, is would sanctions unilaterally have impact? That's really what it comes down to.
I do not believe U.S. sanctions would stop Iran's enrichment program permanently.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Zahrani?
Senator, I think U.S. Financial power and influence is enormous and would have an impact. Would it stop a nuclear program alone? I don't think so. I've argued for a long time that the use of financial power and influence has to be part of a broader strategy of influence and leverage against the regime to bring them to the table and also to get them to stop movement toward a nuclear program. And
you're experts in this, both of you.
Yeah.
Do you believe that they have to have enrichment capability in order to have a peaceful nuclear program in Iran?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
No. So I'm not a nuclear physicist, but my understanding of the issue is absolutely
not. I know it's not your field. Go
on. But it raises an interesting point because you talk about that having been a concession up front. The other problem with the structure is we may be conceding most favored nation status in terms of a sanctions regime. Again, this is part of my problem with the structure. Given the structure, we're now allowing Iran a process and a vehicle to challenge the use of U.S. financial power. And, oh, by the way, we've put it in a context where the Chinese and the Russians, which are no fans or in favor of U.S. power, financial power in particular, have a voice and a vote. And so I think the very structure of that is debilitating, not just with respect to Iran, but more broadly to the use of our power for these other issues that we care about. So it goes to this question of, have we given Iran a most favored nation status in terms of how we've negotiated this deal?
Mr. Chairman, I'm out of time, but I want to echo Senator Menendez's point. I'm very troubled by the side deals, and I know that side deals are deals directly done between the IAEA inspectors and individual countries is normal practice. This is not normal practice. We're signing a deal for the future of America, and it assumes that that those deals are part of this deal, the way I read this document. And in this document, those special deals are not mentioned. And I am really troubled that we're not going to be able to get the best advice from those people. I just don't know how we can make a decision without that, frankly. I'd encourage more pressure to be put on the IAEA to come before us to explain that. There may be very good explanations. But when I hear the types of inspection processes that are going to be done in places like Parchin, which are not mentioned in this document at all, I'm very troubled by that. Sorry.
Well, I think